Okay, so our next speaker will be Vlad Stirbu from CompliancePal. Vlad is a software engineer and the co-organizer of APIdays Finland. Today he will talk about continuous automation.
Hello. So if you are asking why your printed program is out of sync with what you see here, the reason is that I found out about that I have to give this talk yesterday at around 6. So how to say it, there were some reasons why some speakers were not here, but I was on the bench, and as any football team is like, the football team is as good as the substitutes. So I hope that you can hold on here, and thank you very much for being so many at this this hour here. So the talk is about mostly about my background is in doing compliance for medical devices, and in this industry you have to do a lot of documentation, and you don't do it willfully or with pleasure. So if you are in this situation, I try to not be too boring with the specific of the medical software, and hopefully you can take something back back home. So who am I? So I founded this company, CompliancePal, and the idea behind it is to automate the compliance activities that are required while if you are a manufacturer of a medical device that incorporates software. And before the implementation of this is like augmenting GitHub workflows with specific work, specific compliance workflows and document templates, so that makes it easier to follow the regulations. Before that, I have been for something like 17, 18 years in Nokia Corporation. So I started when the cellular was like going up, and then I moved to Nokia Research, and the last part was developing medical software there and seeing what are the, let's say, what kind of friction you get when you ask developers from different backgrounds to write documentation. So this is already well known here, no need to repeat it, but the idea is that, okay, so it looks quite simple, but actually software is nowadays everywhere. So we see a lot in online services, but it is basically starts to be like embedded into the fabric of the world. So any kind of device these days tends to be or aspires to be a connected device. And the amount of the software that exists in software devices can be seen here. Like in the 70s, this was research labs, universities, government. So it go out into the like at large. The industry adopted software into more and more products, and they need to come up with ways of managing how they are creating the products. And of course, like the first one is like waterfall, so you have very well-defined steps that needs to be followed in sequence. That worked for a while till like 2001, something like that, around that time when the Agile Manifesto emerged. And the idea there was that, okay, you follow the plan, but the situation changes and you need to change what the software does, and it's kind of hard. It's no, because the plan, you have some products, especially if the you have to follow regulations, they have long product cycles, so there are problems. And Agile provided an answer to that. But it was like coming back from the waterfall, where you have well-defined phases of a project, and you have like specialized people that take care of certain aspects of it. They were practically dumped by the time we adopted Agile as an industry. And you ended up with something that was like really fast to change, but few people knew what was happening inside there. Around 2015, I think that this DevOps term got crystallized, and it tried to put some structure into Agile. So now you have automation, you could build the software automatically. Some of the documentation was brought back into the process, and so on. And nowadays, there are all flavor of things that are incorporated into DevOps pipelines. We have seen before, like the one or two speakers before me, they mentioned it. So I call them like DevOps plus plus. So many people call them DevSecOps, and so on. So there are many things that go into this, let's say, umbrella. But if you like simplify things, so basically this is how like the most common use of Agile, how it looks like. So it is called Scrum, and the basic idea here is that you develop, you have the requirements in the product backlog. Then you have increments called sprints, and in each sprint the team commits to a subset of it. They are implemented, and then you have product increments that are released to the users, and this is how it goes. But we all know that we live in this world, so developers are hard to convince to work on documentation because this is not like fulfilling or whatever. I mean, there are many reasons, some like valid, some not so valid. But anyway, this is the situation. And you end up, so you develop, everybody is happy, so you have a high speed of developing a product, and then there is the time to release it, and yes, the version 1.0 is there, goes to market, the best medical product, and then everybody notices that on the label there is to be this small mark here, which is conformance with the regulations of the European Union. Other geographies have their own, which might be like industry specific, like in United States, the FDA, so Food and Drug Administration. So that is like a very small mark there. Some products have it with a label sticked on it, but what does it mean? So in because we are in France, we will talk about European Union. So there are two bodies of legislation. So one is from is called Medical Device Directive, which will be superseded by Medical Device Regulation from May 2020, and they describe what safety means for a medical device in this territory. So if you are not obeying these regulations, you are in big trouble because they are big penalties, monetary and other penalties for not obeying. And because those are, that is legislation, again, like very few people understand what that means. So it's very, very difficult to see what the legalese is, although European Union translates them in all the languages, but this is how it goes. But luckily there are ISO, so International Standards Organization, that comes up with technical standards which are harmonized, so you don't have to be concerned with geography, so like what is in Europe or in United States, because they are the governments in all these regions, they took care that, okay, if you implement what they say, then that is fine. And in particular for medical products, we have three standards that are relevant. So about quality management, you need to ensure that you have implemented what the users expect and nothing more. And risk management, that you have a unified, let's say, framework in which you assess the risks of your device. And the risk could be like there is harmless, that so class one is harmless if nothing happens to the user or to the personnel that uses the device or the environment, to class two if there are injuries that you foresee, like using the service or the device, there are injuries, and the most critical is class C, which can lead to like critical injury or death. So you need to be very careful like what devices these devices do. So for example, if you have a cloud connected insulin pump that is losing, that it doesn't have a delivery or exactly once, so the patient will be dead within like tens of seconds, so it's like that fast. This is like the last one of them is a standard that defines what are the procedures that you have to follow when you develop the software. And if you look at them, they look quite harmless, or you could see them that they make sense. So you start with the software development planning. There are the requirements analysis, how you define your software architecture, detailed software design, then the software is implemented, and there are unit verification, then it's like how you integrate all the pieces together, how you test your system, and how you release it. And if you follow this plan, so remember everything was happy and beforehand, you have or many organizations, they have come up with this invention called the documentation sprint. And while you have a pile of, so during the regular sprints, you create, the teams are working and they create all kind of artifacts, which are like requirements, wikis, commits, configuration, test, containers, deployments, and all kind of other things that, so the list expands basically every day, so people are automating more and more stuff. And out of these artifacts, in the documentation sprint, you need to create documentation for different audiences. And they are developers, they are designers, they are the architects of the system, the management, system administrators, so the people that how you operate the system, end users, and then because we are like talking about regulations, auditors, because they will come at some point to see what is happening. And this is like, so I'm from Finland, and this is the president of Nokia Corporation. And so he's the guy that basically saved the company. And this is how he says it. Like, you think change is going now faster than ever before? No, so obviously it's not. You are looking at it the wrong way. So changer will never be as slow as it is today. So if you have a faster and faster pace during development time, if you don't have automation where you create the documentation, there will be a gap that is like you will never be able to bridge that gap or to close it. And this is obvious because this is what is basic, what you basically see during the documentation sprint. So there are all those artifacts like in a different state of decay, because that's like what is happening, yeah? So people don't have time to update them. People left the organization. People forgot the why things are like they are. And I can say it for myself, is like you could even like look at it as who was this stupid guy that wrote it? And the stupid guy was like you 1 year ago, yes? So things happen. So so far I have showed mostly what are the problems, and let's see if there are any solutions. So GitHub Flow was introduced or popularized by GitHub, but in different flavor is available to other Git vendors. So the idea here is that whenever you have a new feature that you want to implement, you make a branch out of the common code. Then there are some commit. You develop the feature. You add commits there, and when you think that everything is ready, you open a pull request, and then a discussion starts, and then you have a couple of rounds, like the code needs to be corrected, new commits are coming, and then when everything is done, is ready to merge. And this one has worked like amazingly well for code itself, obviously, like but it has been adopted for other purposes too. So we have infrastructure as code, we have documentation as code, we have many things as code nowadays, like security as code, compliance as code, like checking your cloud installation, whatever like you have in there. And this is like, instead of, I don't know, looking for many things, like, well, we have a model that scaled quite well, why not use it? And if you have documentation tasks, and this would be like, this is an example from CompliancePal, is that, of course, you could, GitHub provides you API to look into every commit. And developers are so familiar with seeing like, okay, everything is green, you have some tests that are failing. So the idea here would be that why not augment this workflow that worked so well with custom checks that will tell the developers like, in certain situation, you need more information. And this is like a commit check is like not very, very visible, but the idea there is that, okay, you tell the developer that he needs to say what he has used, why he has used the third-party component, which is very common these days. And also informing the developer how to fix the problem. He follows the instructions, makes a new commit, everything is green, perfect. So he does that, and then the compliance officer comes into the picture. And during the review, so the review is not only for developers. Anybody can be involved in a review in the GitHub flow. And the idea here, in my case, would be that I make a view that is, how to say it, customized or made specifically for this kind of audience, so that they can get in. They can feel welcomed into using this tool, and they could understand what is happening there. So the trick or what is the meaning of this is that there have been changes in four dependencies changes, and the yellow ones are changes, and the green one is new. So again, like. Coming up with a common metaphor into this kind of track change system, so even the text editors, they have it these days. So, you do all these activities as in a continuous way. So, you have a seamless experience. Git and through all vendors, like each flavor, they provide the APIs so that you could extend and create new workflows. So for these ones, like if you are a developer and an architect, everything is fine. So you already have everything that you need. So visual code in this case, because they need to use YAML or other things to or these formats to produce the content. You have linters, everything, so that to make their life easier, so that they just play along. Yes, if the tools plays nice to the audience will eventually play nice. And then for these other people that are not like GitHub does not cater or the UI is not appropriate, you create customized UIs and just hook into the flow. So to conclude, ideally, you should start from the beginning. So know in which environment you are for, or for which environment you are developing a product. And if you need to do any kind of documentation or you are mandated to do it, just start collecting, let's call it metadata, or the thing that will allow you later on to build the documentation. Yes, and do it during development with each commit. So that is the time when the information is the freshest and is the most accurate. So obviously the understanding and the environment or the thinking behind the system evolves. And the idea here is that you need to document it at the time when it happened with the understanding that you had at that time. It can change over time and that is okay. I mean, the same as the code and everything, it changes, you know, you have a track record of what happened. Find a real use for the documentation. There are many cases where the information that is collected for one purpose can be used in others. So it's just you end up with a single model of or source of truth, and the documentation becomes like different views of the same that are derived from the same model. And do it for real and not by obligation. The nice thing about these ISO standards, which might sound a bit weird because, yes, as I said, like developers don't want to do it. I'm a developer myself, is that they are practically best practices. They tell you what you have to obtain, not how you have to obtain them, and they give you a lot of freedom of how you can achieve the goal in your own environment. And then, yes, I think that after the... So I wanted to have a slide, but didn't have that time. So there is no one ring to rule them all. So be, in a way, how is opportunistic, use whatever is out there. These are ideas to take home. Augment what is not there, use what you have. And in the end, everything is like DevOps. And add your flavor to it, your third or fourth plus there. Thank you.
Thank you, Vlad. Are there any questions? We still have a few minutes for questions, so. Okay, if there are no questions, then thank you again, Vlad. And you can find Vlad, I think, today still. Yes. So thank you so much.